So last day, I have made a brief description about the MOS amplifier. So in fact, we have considered the common source MOS amplifier. So let me very quickly recapitulate what we have drawn, the circuit. So we have a drain resistance like that. And a simple NMOS amplifier has been constructed using this. So you have a supply like VDD. RD was the drain resistance, and the output was obtained from this particular terminal, and input was applied at the gate terminal. And accordingly, we have also found out what was the value of the voltage gain. So to be more precise, the voltage gain mod of AV is given by GM times R naught parallel RT. So R naught, as you understand, is the output resistance of the MOS device, and RD is the externally connected resistance. Now, since we are talking about the analog MOS circuit design, and the entire design is being done on an integrated chip, so it will be ridiculous to use a discrete resistance like this. So today we will see different variants of common source amplifier, common source MOS amplifier. So firstly, I'll start my discussion by replacing this resistance by means of a MOS device. So in the very first class on this particular subject, I have discussed that. So whenever the MOS device is being operated in a deep triad region, a linear region, then the terminal between the drain to source can be regarded as a simple resistance, and the resistance value will obviously vary with the input voltage. So why not to use a MOS amplifier to do the operation of a simple resistance? So for this particular purpose, let us just modify this circuit. What I mean to say is that I should have a MOS device to replace this resistance. In fact, this MOS device, this one, what I'm drawing right now, will be acting as a load. So this is the gate terminal. Now suppose I have started with the NMOS device. So you have VDD over here. And this potential might be some constant value like VB. And let me call this MOS as M2. And let you have another MOS, which will act as an amplifier, an amplifying device, the lower one, another NMOS amplifier. So let it be M1. And the input is being applied at the gate of the lower amplifier, a lower MOS, that is M1. And source is directly connected to ground, and we are taking the output from this terminal, Vout. In fact, what is done is, the upper transistor, upper MOS, M2, will act as a resistance in a deep triad region. So you have to ensure that the gate-to-source voltage and the drain-to-source voltage, the relationship between these two voltages will be such that the corresponding value, I mean VGS minus VTH, this value must be, so we have two different components. One is VGS minus VTH, and which is also known as overdrive voltage. And we have another component, that is the drain to source voltage. And remember, here the source is connected to Vout. That means the source is connected to the output terminal. So whenever you talk about the VGS, so this is nothing but VB minus Vout. And also for the upper transistor, that is M2, VGS for M2, is given by VB minus V out, and VDS for M2 is given by VDD minus V out. So as you can observe from this particular expression, that the source potential of the upper transistor M2 is connected to the output terminal. So the source potential is not constant. Now, since the source is not constant, so whatever be the value at the bulk potential, so obviously you should have a bulk potential that is let it be represented by V capital B. It will be difficult for you to keep a track of the source potential. So we should have a body effect, and accordingly, the corresponding gain expression will be different. So that's why what you can do is, in order to get rid of the body effect, instead of using an NMOS transistor as a substitute of the resistance RD, what we can do, we can replace this one, this NMOS transistor, by means of a PMOS transistor. Now, if I just replace this one by means of PMOS transistor, as you know, for a PMOS transistor, the source is connected to the VDD, the supply line. So now, for the PMOS transistor, so I think it will be better if I just redraw new circuit. So let me just erase that part, what we have already done. So that was for NMOS. And let me draw a new circuit using PMOS device. So the PMOS device is being used to replicate the operation of a resistance. And this potential is VDD. For a PMOS device, the source is connected to the supply line, that is VDD. And we do have the lower transistor M1, which will amplify the signal. So this is your Vin. And suppose this potential equal to VB. So we do have M2 over here, M1 over here. The only difference what we have made over here is that we have just replaced the NMOS transistor M2 by means of a PMOS transistor in order to get rid of the body effect. So this is the ground, and we're taking the output from this terminal V out.
Excuse me, sir.
Do you have any?
Sir, yes, sir. Why there is no body effect in PMOS transistor?
Okay. Let me tell. So if I consider a simple MOS device like this, as you know, let me consider simple, let it be an NMOS device. So as you know, this is the drain terminal, this is the source terminal, and this is the gate terminal. Now, whenever, and obviously there is a third terminal, rather the fourth terminal, which is known as the second gate, which is known as the bulk or body. So let this be identified by VB or simple V. Now for a particular temperature, if I consider, for a particular temperature, the threshold voltage is constant. However, the threshold voltage is a function of VSB, that is the voltage difference between the source terminal and the bulk or body terminal. We have already seen that this VTH can be written like VTH 0 plus some gamma, and we have this component minus root over of twice pi f. So when VSB equal to 0, that means when the source and the bulk, they are having the same potential, then obviously what happens? The threshold voltage will be equal to VTH0 if VSB equal to 0. So that is the target, you know, to make the source and the bulk potential be the same. But the scenario is not so easy for an NMOS device. Why? Because as you find, for an NMOS device, the source is connected to the output terminal. However, in case of PMOS device, the source is connected to a constant supply, that is VDD. Now, if the source is connected to some constant supply like VDD, and if you make the bulk potential equal to VDD, if you connect the bulk terminal or the substrate potential equal to VDD, then obviously the source to bulk potential, that difference, VSB will be equal to zero. So the threshold voltage will be remaining constant. And we will be discussing this issue in much more detail whenever we will be considering the diode connected load in this particular lecture. So
okay, sir.
If I have a PMOS device like this on the top of the NMOS device, so we have to ensure that the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, this VGS minus VTH, which is known as overdrive voltage. So as you know, this overdrive voltage must be greater than the drain to source voltage so that the device can operate, the upper device, this M2, can operate in the linear region. Remember, whenever we are operating the lower transistor as an amplifying device, so it will be operating in the saturation region, because the reason we have discussed in the last two classes, why we prefer to operate the MOS device in the saturation region for the purpose of amplification. But we are using the upper transistor M2 as a load. And accordingly, the value of VB is so chosen, which is nothing but the potential at the gate terminal for the upper MOS or the PMOS. So it is so chosen that the gate to source overdrive, I mean VGS minus VTH, must be high enough. It should be greater than the VDS. What is the VDS? This is nothing but Vout minus VDD. So obviously you have to consider the modulus value here, because as you understand, for an NMOS device, the VGS value is greater than zero. However, for PMOS device, the VGS value is less than zero because the source is connected to the positive supply, that is VDD. So if I just consider the mod value of that, so mod VGS minus VTH should be greater than mod VDS so that the transistor M2 will act in the triode region. That means the difference between the gate terminal and the source terminal should be high enough. Now, source is already connected to VDD, so therefore, the value of VB, this potential, should be small enough so that the difference between gate and source is large, and which can drive the transistor M2 into the triode region. And in the triode region, one can easily find out the expression for the on resistance, R on. We have already calculated that value. And the value is given.
I ask something?
Let me just complete this line.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So it is like mu n C aux. W by L of the PMOS or M2. And then we have VDD minus VB minus mod VTHP. So as you understand, for a PMOS device, the threshold voltage is a negative quantity. For an NMOS device, the threshold voltage is a positive quantity. So that's why we have used a modulus sign over here. So mu n C aux W by L of the PMOS transistor multiplied with VGS minus VTH. So we have already derived that expression for an NMOS device. It is nothing but 1 upon, oh, I think it will be mu P, because we are talking about PMOS. So it will be mu P. Let me just correct this one. So mu P C aux W by LP VDD minus VB minus mod of VDHP. So this is nothing but the R on, or rather RD. And accordingly, one can find out the expression for the voltage gain, like GM of the lower transistor, that is GM of the NMOS, GM of M1, multiplied with R0 parallel RT. So R0 is coming from the lower transistor, and RD is coming from the upper transistor. So RD or R on, we have already derived that expression. So here our objective is to replace the resistance RD by means of a MOS device. So that can be done using this particular arrangement. However, this arrangement is having some limitation. So while discussing the different attributes of amplifier, I have mentioned that one of the important attributes of amplifier is to ensure that the gain should be constant over a wide range of operation. So that is one of the difficulty because of which we have seen that this GM, the transconductance or mutual conductance of the MOS device, it's a strong function of the overdrive voltage. So you have seen that this GM is a strong function of the overdrive voltage, and that imposes a significant limitation on using this type of amplifier practically. Now, if I just consider this type of amplifier where the RD or the drain resistance is being replaced by another MOS amplifier, here you see that apart from the GM, the R on or RD value, it also depends upon the externally applied voltage. For example, if I consider this mu P C aux, so these are the technology dependent parameters. So we can consider W by L to be constant for a particular device dimension, but mu P C aux is a technology dependent parameter. VTHP, the threshold voltage, is a function of temperature. And obviously the R on value is highly sensitive to the selection of the bias voltage, that is VB. So therefore, it is not a very good solution to use or to replace RD by means of a simple PMOS device like this. However, for a first calculation, we can consider that this can give you some new dimension, some new avenue towards the design of analog MOS amplifier. And this is this architecture is known as, so let me just point out the name of the architecture. This is known as the common source amplifier. Common source amplifier. With triode load. So in fact, we have a MOS device over here. PMOS, M2, we have three different terminals. And three terminals are active. Source terminal is connected to VDD. Drain terminal is connected to the drain of the NMOS. And the gate terminal is connected to some arbitrary voltage, that is VB, some bias voltage, that is VB. So since all these three terminals are active, so that's why this type of amplifier is known as a CS amplifier, a common source stage amplifier with triode load. So all the three electrodes of the MOS device is active. So that's why it's known as a triode load. In fact, if I just consider the triode region of operation for a MOS device, here we find that the value of the drain to source current or drain current is essentially dependent upon the potential at all three terminals. So ID in the linear or triode region is a function of gate potential, source potential, as well as drain potential. So that's why it is known as a triode region or linear region, where the ID and VDS, their variation can be considered to be a linear variation, and the corresponding R1 value can be calculated by means of this particular equation. However, if I consider the saturation region of MOS characteristics, there you will find that if I just neglect the effect of the channel length modulation, you'll find that effectively the current, the drain current, is a function of gate to source voltage. If I just forget about, I mean, very briefly, if I just want to draw the corresponding VI characteristics for a MOS device, so ID versus VDS. So as you know, it looks something like this. If I just forget about the channel length modulation, you'll see that it is something like that. So over here, this is almost linear. And here it is almost constant. If I just, okay, I think I have intentionally used the channel length modulation. Let me once again draw. It is something like that. So over here, it's a function of, so this is the triad region where the ID value depends upon both the value of VGS and VDS. So this is for a particular value of VGS, so this is for VGS1, this is for VGS2, and so on. So here the value depends upon both VGS and VDS. That means all the three potentials, VG, VS, and VD. So all of them are responsible in modulating the value of ID in the triad region. However, in the linear region, in the saturation region, as you find, the drain current is a function of only drain to, only gate to source voltage. If I just forget about the effect of the channel length modulation. And since all these three terminals are used here, so this particular architecture is known as the common source amplifier with triode load. So now, if I move forward, once again, let me go back to the fundamental architecture, I mean the common source amplifier with a drain resistance like this, RD, and this one is VDD. Now we have seen that one alternative is to replace this one is Vin, and we are taking the output from this terminal. Now we have seen that one alternative is to replace RD by means of a MOS device and operating the MOS device in the triode region. Now if I operate the MOS device in the triode region, then the value of the resistance is essentially a function of the terminal voltages, and it limits its operation, or it limits its operation as a substitute of a resistance. So what if the next option, what can come to our mind is that apart from operating the MOS device as a simple MOS operating in the linear region or triad region, if I want to operate the MOS in the saturation region, then what happens? Can it still be used as a substitute of resistance? Yes or no? So we have to answer this question. So one option to use the MOS as in the saturation region is to make it gate and drain short circuited. So we have a MOS device like this, NMOS, for example. Now this is the gate terminal, this is the drain terminal, this is the source terminal. Now if I tie up these two terminals together, gate and drain together, what happens? We find that VG equal to VD, gate potential equal to the drain potential. Therefore, VGS equal to VDS, irrespective of the source potential, VGS equal to VDS. So therefore, we know that VGS minus VTH, that value is less than VDS. And this is the condition of saturation. So for any MOS device for which the gate and drain terminal, they are connected together, it will always operate in the saturation region. Now we have initially tried to replace the resistance RD by means of a MOS operating in the linear region or triad region. And accordingly, we have to provide some bias terminal, bias potential at the gate terminal. And we have seen that the resistance value is a function of the technology parameter and the bias potential. Now the next option that we are now right now exploring is that let us try to use the MOS in the saturation region, and let us check whether this can be used as a substitute of a resistance. Similarly, if I consider a PMOS device, so for a PMOS device, as you understand, the gate and drain must be connected together. So both of them can be used either in MOS or PMOS, but they are having their relative advantages and disadvantages, and I'll be discussing the corresponding advantages or disadvantages associated with the NMOS device and the PMOS device. Now if I start with an NMOS device with a connection like this, so this is the drain terminal and we have a gate terminal where gate and drain are short circuited, and let me consider that this will act as a resistance. So obviously if I find out the potential difference between this drain and source, and if I measure the corresponding current, so obviously you'll be having some impedance. Now let us check what is that value. Now to find out the equivalent resistance of a MOS device connected in this fashion, so we have to take the help of the small signal model. So as you know, in the small signal model we have a voltage dependent current source which is equal to GM V1, where V1 is input voltage and apart from that we have R0 if I want to incorporate the effect of channel length modulation. So this is the drain terminal, this is the drain terminal, and if I consider the gate terminal, the corresponding voltage over here is V1, and here gate and drain, they are connected together. So this one is the gate terminal, so gate and drain, they are connected together. So I need to find out what is the, this one is the source terminal, I need to find out what is the effective impedance between this drain and source. So what I need to do is that I have to apply some external voltage like Vx between these two terminals, and let us try to find out what is the current being drawn by the structure itself. So if the voltage equal to Vx and if the current being taken by Ix, then the impedance or the resistance that we are looking at is given by Vx upon Ix. So now you have to equate the current Ix with these two components. What we find here is V1 is equal to, V1 is the potential applied over here at the gate terminal, and since gate and drain, they are connected together, so V1 equal to Vx. So this Ix is having two different components. One is, so I can write Ix is equal to GM times V1 plus Vx upon R0. So since V1 equal to Vx, so it will be nothing but GM times Vx plus Vx by R0. So Ix by Vx, which is nothing but the reciprocal of the resistance, is given by GM plus 1 upon R0.
Sir, are we considering source to be grounded?
No, we are not considering anything over here. Okay, we will be considering that part. We will be considering that part whenever we have connected this device into the actual circuit.
Yes, sir, but then Vx should be applied with respect to ground only, sir.
With respect to. We are applying the Vx with respect to these two terminals only. We are applying Vx between these two terminals. We don't know where this source terminal is connected. Okay. And whenever we connect this source terminals, okay, I am taking up your question in the next slide. Whenever I'll be using that particular device into the circuit itself. So far I am considering that we have a drain terminal, we have a gate terminal, we have a source terminal, and gate and drain are shorted. together and let us try to find out what is the value of the impedance. So I don't know what about the potential at the source terminal. Might be it might be connected to ground or it might be connected to some other potential.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if I just consider the value of Ix upon Vx, so that will give me Gm plus 1 upon R naught. So the conductance, if I consider the Ix upon Vx, that will be the conductance. So that conductance is given by Gm plus 1 upon R naught. So what will be the value of the effective resistance, or if I write like R effective? So R effective is nothing but, so since this Gm and 1 upon R naught, they are connected in series, I mean, they are connected like Gm plus 1 by R naught. So this R effective is nothing but 1 upon Gm parallel R naught. So this is the effective value of the resistance, 1 upon Gm parallel R naught. And since R naught value is very large, so I can effectively consider this effective value of the resistance for this diode connected load. So this type of load is known as a diode connected load. Why diode connected load? Now, instead of having three terminals, now we have only two different terminals, because gate and drain, they are connected together. So it is known as a diode connected load. Now we have only two electrodes to operate. One is the source terminal and the second one is the drain terminal, for example, because gate and drain, they are tied together. So that's what is known as a diode connected load. Last time in the previous example, I have considered the three terminals separately. So I can tune the three terminals, the corresponding potentials can be triggered. I mean, the gate potential, drain potential, and the source potential. Now gate and drain, they are tied together. So now we have only two terminals. So that's the two electrodes are available. So that's why it is known as a diode connected load. And we find that the effective value of the resistance is given by approximately 1 upon Gm, if I just neglect the value of R naught, which is pretty large to some extent. So this is the scenario whenever we have some diode connected load like this in isolation. Now let us try to incorporate the same thing into the actual circuit and let us see what happens. Now in the actual circuit, whenever we connect the same thing, so if I just once again consider the actual circuit, so we have an NMOS device on the top of another NMOS device. So the upper one will act as a load and the lower one will amplify the signal. So this is the Vout terminal. So it will be your VDD. You have M1, M2, Vin, and these two are tied together. Now, obviously, we have the second gate, the fourth terminal of this MOS, M1. And if I connect this terminal, this bulk potential to the ground terminal, then as you can find, for this NMOS, for considering the upper NMOS first, so for the upper NMOS, the bulk potential is connected to the ground terminal, and we have a different source potential. Source potential equal to the V out potential. So VSB is not equal to zero. So here, the impact of body effect has to be considered. Now, if you want to consider the impact of body effect, so let us once again redraw the circuit and the corresponding small signal equivalent model. So we have a VDD over here. Now we know that, so gate and drain, they are connected together. Now we know that this potential is not equal to the ground potential. Rather, this potential is having or is kept at some other potential, this value. the potential at the source terminal for the MOS M1 and which is acting as a load. Knowing that, this potential is grounded, that means the bulk potential. So I have my circuit over here. Beneath this load, I have the circuit over here. And whenever I am using this one as my load, so I have to find out what is the value of the impedance being provided by this one, by the transistor M1, by the MOS M1. So what we can do is, we can connect, to find out the impedance, we can connect some external voltage source over here like Vx. And suppose the current being drawn is, say, let it be say Ix. So you can easily find out what is the value of the resistance being offered by this M1. Now to do that, the last time if you just considered the last example, here we don't know what about the potential at the gate terminal, what about the potential at the drain terminal. The only thing we know is that the gate and drain, they are sorted together. But this time we know that if I want to use the M1 as a load for this amplifier, so obviously the gate terminal and drain terminal, both of them should be connected to the potential VDD. So now we can modify the small signal model that we have already drawn previously. So we have GM times V1. Between the drain and the source terminal. Suppose this is the source terminal. And the potential over here, the input potential is nothing but V1. So we have a source terminal over here. And remember, this source is not grounded. For the transistor M1, the source is not grounded. So we have a source terminal like this. So what about this V1? V1 is nothing but this potential with respect to gate. And we know that this potential is connected to ground. Gate is connected to ground. Why? Because gate is connected to VDD. So in the small signal model, VDD means a constant voltage. Therefore, in the small signal equivalent model, it is connected to AC ground. Now, apart from GM V1, we should have the other parameter, that is R0, obviously, as you know. And this R0 implies the effect of channel length modulation. And then we have the second current source, that is GMV times VBS. GMV times VBS. What about the drain potential? As you know, drain potential is connected to VDD for M1. So therefore, it is connected to AC ground. And the current being drawn over here is Ix. If I look at this particular terminal, at the source terminal, I do have a Vx, externally connected potential, that is Vx. And then I need to find out what is the impedance being seen by some circuit element which will use M1 as its load. So what we can do is we can simply apply KVL. So first of all, as you see, so Vx is the potential at the source with respect to ground, and V1 is just the opposite. So obviously V1 is equal to minus Vx. And what about VBS? So VBS is nothing but VB minus Vs. So the bulk potential or body potential for MOS M1 is equal to zero. It is connected to AC ground. So this is minus Vs, that is minus Vx, because the source potential equal to Vx. So now we can apply the KVL. So as you find, the current Ix can be written like Ix plus Gm times V1 plus Gmb times VBS is equal to Vx by R0. Now V1 is equal to minus Vx and VBS is also equal to minus Vx. So I can take this part, the right hand side. So ultimately it will be nothing but Vx into Gm plus Gmb plus 1 upon R0, Vx by R0. So Ix by Vx from this expression is coming like Gm plus Gmb plus 1 upon R0. So last time we have seen that it was like Gm plus 1 upon R0, and this time it is nothing but Gm plus Gmb plus 1 upon R0. So if I want to find out the effective resistance or R effective, so R effective is nothing but 1 upon Gm plus Gmb and the parallel combination with R0. And that can be approximated to 1 upon Gm plus Gmb. So last time we have found out the corresponding approximated value for R effective. It was like only 1 upon Gm without considering the body effect. Now this time the body effect is prominent, so we have to incorporate the effect of an impact of the body effect. And if I assume that R0 is pretty large with respect to this 1 upon Gm plus Gmb, then that can be approximated to 1 upon Gm plus Gmb. So whenever you have a circuit like this with an NMOS device connected as a load, you cannot get rid of the body effect, and accordingly the effective value of the resistance or R effective is given by 1 upon Gm plus Gmb. So the resistance RD that you are trying to substitute by means of a MOS device M1 operated in the saturation region, the value of R effective or RD is given by 1 upon Gm plus Gmb. Now with this knowledge, let us now move to the main circuit. Let me once again draw the main circuit. So we have two MOS device. In fact, both of them are NMOS. And the upper one is acting as a diode connected load. So only two terminals are accessible, either gate or drain and the source, the upper or M2, and the lower one is acting as an amplifier itself. So this is the output terminal. So having considered, so now this entire thing, what I've drawn over here, this entire thing is equivalent. So in fact, we have between the drain to source of M2. In fact, what we can visualize is between these two terminals, we have a simple resistance. So that resistance is being replaced by means of this MOS device operated in the saturation region. So what I can visualize it as a resistance. So that is a visualization. So in fact, it is not connected. So that RD, what we are looking at, can be thought like this. So it's not an additional resistance. Remember, it's not an additional resistance. So we're just visualizing this as a resistance. So now with this knowledge, one can easily find out the expression for the gain. Even in fact, I'm talking about the modulus value of gain, or if you also consider the exact value of gain, so I can also get rid of the modulus. Otherwise, you can keep it as it is, no problem. So the expression was Gm times RD. Now this GM corresponds to the GM of the lower transistor, so GM of 1, GM 1 times RT, and RD is being replaced by the effective resistance as seen by this particular MOS, that is M1. And we have seen that it will be GM1 multiplied with 1 upon GM2 plus GMB2. Because the effective resistance as perceived by this MOS is given by 1 upon GM2 plus GMB2. So I am just neglecting the RO value or output impedance. So that can be written like, so you have GM1 and it is GM2 plus eta times GM2. And that expression we have already discussed, derived last day, that GMB, the corresponding mutual conductance, taking body effect into account, is given by eta times of GM. So GM1 by GM2. 1 by 1 plus eta. So ultimately, this is the expression for gain when we have considered direct connected load like this. The expression says that the AV or mod value of the gain is given by GM1 upon GM2 multiplied with 1 by 1 plus eta. Now we have to find out the expression for GM1 and GM2. So GM1 stands for the mutual conductance for this transistor, and GM2 stands for the mutual conductance for this transistor. Now already in some of the previous lectures, we have seen that, or I think it will be better if I once again find out the expression. I think that will be easier for you. So the device, MOS device operating in saturation region can be represented like half of mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So if I just find out the expression for GM, that is nothing but del ID by del VGS. And that value is given by mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH. And if you just replace this VGS minus VTH with respect to ID and mu n and C aux and W by L, then ultimately that expression was like root over of twice ID mu n C aux W by L. So that is the popular expression of mutual conductance. So you can replace any of the variables. Either you can replace the entire thing with respect to mu and C aux, W by L and ID, or what you can do is you can replace this W by L with respect to the other parameters, overdrive voltage. So that depends upon you. So it will be convenient for the following discussion to represent the mutual conductance in this fashion, root over of twice ID mu and C aux, W by L. Now under this condition, if I just find out the expression for gain, in fact the mod value. So as you know, it is nothing but GM1 by GM2 into 1 by 1 plus eta. And each of the GMs can be represented like twice, so let it be twice ID1, mu n, C aux, W by L of the transistor 1 divided by root over of twice ID2 mu n C aux W by L of the transistor 2 multiplied with 1 by 1 plus eta. So now if you just go back to the circuit, so you understand that the same drain current is flowing through both of these two transistors. So ID1 must be equal to ID2. So for the purpose of analysis, I have considered two different ID, but in fact, we have the same ID that is flowing through these two transistor combination, M1 and M2. So ID1 equal to ID2. So then this equation can be further simplified, like, and we have mu and C of, if I assume that both of them are constructed using the same CMOS technology, so obviously mu n is obviously constant, and considering that oxide capacitance is also fixed, so ultimately this entire expression reduces to root over of W by L of the first transistor upon W by L of the second transistor. And obviously we have this 1 by 1 plus eta. And if I assume that eta varies slightly with the corresponding variation in the output voltage, then I can consider the output, I mean the gain of the amplifier is being controlled by the device dimension. So it is being controlled. So if I assume that this eta doesn't vary with the output voltage, or even if it varies, the corresponding variation is very small, which can be neglected. So ultimately the gain of the overall combination is given by W by L of the first transistor upon the W by L of the second transistor. So if you would like to have a gain of say 20, suppose you want that the voltage gain should be 20, the mod value of the voltage gain should be 20. So you must ensure that W by L 1 must be 400 times of W by L 2. So just by modulating the value of the device dimension, the width by length, W by L ratio of the MOS device, you can basically control the gain of the overall amplifier combination. So that is the beauty of the MOS architecture, that this W by L controls the different attributes, the different features of a MOS device. And here you can see that just by changing the W by L ratio, now we can eventually modulate the gain of the MOS amplifier. And this is known as a diode connected load. And we can also come to the same conclusion. If I just, instead of considering the small signal model, if I just go for mathematical analysis, that means we have started with ID1 is equal to ID2. That was the condition that the drain current flowing through each of these two transistors being the same, and both of them are operating in the saturation region. And from here also, you can come to the same conclusion. So for the first transistor, as you understand, this is given by half mu n Cox W by L1. So I'm just considering the large signal analysis into VGS minus VTH. So what about VGS for the transistor one? So VGS is nothing but V in, because gate terminal for the transistor one is equal to having a voltage of V in. So it will be like V in minus VTH whole square, or VTH one whole square. That is equal to half mu n Cox. So I'm assuming that mu n Cox is constant for a particular device, for a particular CMOS technology. But the device dimension might vary, so W by L2. And what about this voltage? VGS. So gate voltage equal to VDD, source voltage equal to Vout. So VDD minus Vout minus VTH2. So VDD minus Vout. So VG minus VS for the second transistor minus VTH2. Whole square. So after simplification, what we find is root over of W by L of the first transistor multiplied with V in minus VTH1, that is given by, and is equated to W by L2 VDD minus V out minus VTH2. Now from this expression also, you can find out the expression for gain from this equality. So what you can do is you have to differentiate the entire expression with respect to V in. So if I differentiate it with respect to V in, so W by L1, and this value will give you zero, assuming that there is obviously no body effect present for the lower transistor, because for this transistor M1, the source is connected to the ground. So if I connect the bulk potential to the ground terminal, so obviously there will be no body effect. So VTH1 is essentially constant. It doesn't vary with the input voltage. So on the right hand side, we have W by L2. Now VDD is constant. So we have a zero over here, minus del V out by del V in, which is expression for the gain, minus what about this VTH2. So as you can see, for the upper transistor M2, the source is not connected to ground. So obviously there will be some body effect, and the threshold voltage is not constant. And threshold voltage is a function of the source to bulk potential. So obviously you have to take into account the variation of this threshold voltage with respect to the input voltage, because if input varies, if the input voltage varies, the corresponding output voltage is going to vary. And if output voltage varies, the source potential of the upper transistor varies, and accordingly the bulk to source potential varies, and the threshold voltage will also vary. So therefore VTH2 is a function of input voltage. So it will be like del VTH2 by del V in. Now this expression, del VTH2 by del V in, can be represented like as a chain rule. Del VTH2, because it varies directly with, if I just consider the threshold voltage, so threshold voltage varies with the source to bulk potential, and source to bulk potential over here is nothing but VSP, and that is equal to minus VSB over here, source to bulk potential over here is V out. So this VTH2 varies with V out, and obviously V out varies with V in. So that can be represented as a chain rule in this way. And this is nothing but the AV, del V out by del V in. So AV times del VTH2 by del V out. And del V out is nothing but VSB here. I mean, V out is equal to VSB, because VS equal to V out and VB equal to zero. And last year we have already calculated this expression del VTH with respect to del VSB, and that is given by eta. So putting this expression over here, what you find is, so this del V out by del V in will give you AV, and this one will give you, if I just combine together, you'll find that the final expression, in fact, we will be arriving at the same expression what we have got using the small signal model. So there are two different approaches. Either you go by small signal approach, small signal equivalent model, or you go by the mathematical model. So you find that AV, the expression for AV is given by root over of W by L1 by W by L2 into 1 by 1 plus eta. The same expression what you have got. And obviously there is a minus sign outside. Better if I just put modulus over here, mod of AV. So this will identify the gain of this particular circuit. Now, apart from gain, there are defined other attributes. So one thing is very clear, that here the gain value doesn't depend on the input voltage. In fact, it's a function of W by L only, the width by length ratio of the lower transistor and the upper transistor. So W by L1 upon W by L2 square root of that will give you the mod of AV. So it's not a function of the input voltage. So in this way, we can say that the gain is almost constant. If I just forget about the dependence of AV, or if I just forget about the dependence of eta on the output voltage. So if I assume that eta is constant, or it varies slightly, then this 1 by 1 plus eta can be treated to be constant, and then mod of AV is essentially a function of W by L ratio of the two transistors. So that is fine. So that is one of the biggest advantage what we have got using this diode connected load. So this is known as the amplifier, common source amplifier with diode connected load, where, so I think it will be better if I write it down, the name of this particular topology. This is known as the common source amplifier, CS amplifier. Common source amplifier with diode connected load. Last time we have considered the triode connected load, now this time it is diode connected load. Now we have only two terminals for the load, gate and the source, or drain and the source, because gate and drain, they are connected together. So that is fine, but what about the output voltage swing? So we have to consider the output, the corresponding value of the output voltage swing. So since this lower transistor is acting in saturation, so what you can find is, you can visualize this one. I think it will be better if I take a fresh slide and go on explaining. So we have an NMOS transistor like this, with gate and drain, they're connected together, tied together, that is VDD. And over here you have the, I think it was M2 last time. I have mentioned this as M2. So let it be M2. And at this particular point, at the source of M2, we have the transistor M1. And since the M1 is acting in the saturation region, so I can visualize this as current source simply. This can be regarded as a current source with a value equal to I1, for example. But the value of this current source is not constant. The I1 changes depending upon the potential at the different terminals of the MOS M1. Now, whenever the value of the current I1 is very small, then what happens? When I1 varies, so it's not a constant current source, rather the value depends upon the drain to source potential and the gate to source potential. So when the I1 value, if I assume that the I1 is varying, and if I1 is very small, so any reduction in I1 will cause the corresponding reduction in the overdrive voltage. And if the overdrive voltage reduces, then the gate to source potential for the transistor M2 can be treated to be close to the threshold voltage. Now, under this condition, when the gate to source voltage is close to the threshold voltage, then if VGS equal to VTH2, and this condition holds good when the current source, I mean the I1 is very small. So if I1 is small, the corresponding overdrive for this one, for this MOS device is small, and which makes the VGS, the gate to source voltage, equal to the threshold voltage. Now under this condition, the drop between the drain to source is equal to the drop between the gate to source, and that drop is equal to VTH. So under this condition, the output voltage swing, Vout, the swing or the maximum value of Vout is restricted to VDD minus VTH2. And that is one of the limitation of this diode connected load, unlike the triode connected load. So if I consider, if I just go back to the triode connected load with which we have started today's discussion, in case of a triode connected load, so whenever the corresponding drain to source voltage is pretty small, if I consider this one, so when the drain to source voltage is very small, and that is the condition to make the device into the triode region or linear region, the condition is that drain to source voltage is very small, and then it can be equated to zero, and then the output voltage V out is having the maximum value close to VDD. However, this is not true for diode connected load, in which case even if the I1 value is very small, the corresponding value of the gate to source voltage will be approximately equal to the threshold voltage. And since the drain to source drop equal to the threshold voltage, VT is 2 of the second transistor M2, so V out is having the maximum excursion. So this is the maximum excursion or the maximum value. Maximum value is restricted by VDD minus VTH. So now this could have been crucial whenever we are operating the amplifier with a very small drain supply. So if VDD is very small, so in that case, it can be very crucial. Now, so far we have considered that we have an NMOS device on the top of another NMOS device, and the upper NMOS device is acting as a load. And eventually we have found that the expression for the gain is given by root over of W by L1 upon W by L2 multiplied with a factor, and that factor is basically coming because of the body effect. Now, if I want to get rid of the body effect, the option that is available to us is to replace the upper transistor, that is M2, by means of a PMOS device. So we can do the same exercise just by replacing the upper transistor by means of a PMOS device. So if I want to replace the upper transistor by means of PMOS device, the lower one is still the NMOS. So here you find that this is connected to the supply VDD, source is connected to VDD. And you know, for NMOS device, the drain is connected to VDD. And these two are connected together, the gate and the, sorry. Gate and the drain, they are connected together. And the input voltage is applied over here. And this is the output terminal, V out. Now, since the source is connected to VDD and the bulk potential for PMOS device is also connected to the VDD, so that the VSB, the potential drop between the source and the bulk, is equal to zero. And this makes the body effect inactive for this type of arrangement. And over here, you will find that the expression for the voltage gain AV, or mod AV rather, can be written like, so you have W by L for the NMOS divided by W by L of the PMOS. And apart from that, you have this mu n by mu b, because this time we are using two different type of devices, NMOS as an amplifier, amplifying device, PMOS as a load. So you should have mu n upon mu p. And as you know, the value of mu n is greater than mu p. So accordingly, you have to select the value of this W by L ratio so that the gain can be accomplished, because last time we have seen that this mu n by mu p ratio was equal to 1. In fact, we don't have mu p, we have only mu n. So mu n upon mu n. So that value was 1, that ratio was 1. But this time you have mu n upon mu p, and mu n is greater than mu p. And so it will be an added advantage for using this PMOS device. Already we are having a gain of 2. So if I assume that mu n is like twice of mu p, so already we are having a value of 2. And then accordingly, you can increase the value of the W by L ratio for the NMOS transistor so as to achieve a particular value of the gain. But remember that if you make any attempt to increase the value of this W by L ratio for any NMOS device, it will adversely affect the frequency response of the amplifier, because whenever you make any attempt to increase this or to change the value of W by L ratio, the corresponding value of the capacitance will be very large. And as a matter of fact, the transient response of the device. So whenever we'll be talking about the frequency response or the transient response of the amplifier, then you will see that using very high value of the, I mean, if I consider this WL ratio, suppose the L value is very large with respect to the prescribed value, then obviously it will adversely affect the corresponding value of the frequency response or the transient response of the amplifier. Now, having considered this diode connected load, so what we find is ultimately the expression for the gain is essentially given by GM times RD, where RD is nothing but the drain resistance we are selecting in this particular purpose. So the gain expression, so if I just write down over here, the expression for gain for the common source stage is given by GM times RT, GM times RT, GM into RT. Now we have two different challenges over here. The first challenge was that we have already taken care of is to ensure that the GM, since GM is a function of the overdrive voltage, so apparently it seems that the gain expression, the expression for gain will depend upon the input voltage. So if input voltage is small, when GM is small, the gain will be small. If the input voltage or the overdrive voltage is large, then the gain will be large because GM is large, and it may adversely affect the performance of the amplifier in the sense that the corresponding amplifier will be a non-linear amplifier. So we always target to get a linear kind of amplifier where the gain expression remains constant over a wide range of the input signal variation. So that was the first problem that we have encountered with this particular common source type of amplification. And the second problem is that obviously we will be using an amplifier for which the gain is very large. So how to increase the gain? So the option that is available to us to increase the gain is to increase the value of RD, that is the drain resistance. Now, once again, if I just go back to the very fundamental circuit like this, with which you have started last day. Suppose we have a resistance RD over here, and assuming that GM is say, it's constant over a small region of operation. Suppose this is VDD and Vout. So as you can understand from this expression, Vout is given by VDD minus ID times RT. So if you make any attempt to increase the gain by increasing RT, so increase of RT signifies that gain will also increase. So that is the positive part. That is the one advantage we are getting out of that. In fact, while designing any amplifier and MOS amplifier, we do have different types of attributes, and all the attributes cannot be satisfied together. So we have an attribute of having a large gain. We have an attribute of having, so these are the desirable properties. One is the gain, the value of the gain. Second one is the linearity, whether the gain is linear or not. The third one is the power consumption. Then we have the input impedance and output impedance. Then we have the transient response of the bandwidth. And then you also have the voltage swing, the maximum excursion that is available to us. That is also important. And the amplifier circuits, which we have discussed so far, is having one limitation. Apart from the first one, the triad connected load, for triad connected load, we have the excursion, the maximum value of Vout could have been as high as VDD. However, for this diode connected load, the maximum value of the Vout is given by VDD minus IDRT. And if the RT value is large, you know, to make the gain large, if I make any attempt to increase RT, then ultimately it will adversely affect the maximum possible excursion available for the output voltage. So obviously we have to find out some means so that that point can also be arrested. And this could have been done using a simple modification of the previous used circuit. So let me once again draw the circuit. So already this circuit has been drawn over here. So what we have done so far is we have made different options. Like the first one was replace RD by means of a triode connected load. Then we have considered diode connected load. and we have to also understand the relative advantages and disadvantages of each of these loads. Here the problem is for triac connected load, the good part is that the corresponding voltage swing is large because the Vout max can be as high as VDD. But the problem is the gain is not constant because it was like GM times RT or R on, and R on is a strong function of the input voltage. It's also a function of the temperature and the CMOS technology. So that's why it is not at all preferable, the triac connected load. Now, what about the diode connected load? We have seen that if I just tune the value of W by ratio of the two transistors, M1 and M2, we can ultimately modulate or tune the value of the gain. So we don't have any dependence on the terminal voltage. We don't have any dependence on the process parameters. We don't have any dependence on the temperature. So that is fine. That is a good part of the diode connected load. But there is also having a limitation associated with the diode connected load. The limitation is that if I make any attempt to increase the gain of this circuit, then ultimately it will restrict the maximum available swing at the output node. So that is one of the disadvantages, because if you make any attempt to increase RD for increasing the gain, automatically the voltage drop across the resistance RD will also be large, and accordingly the expression, the Vout, the voltage swing available at the output node, will also be reduced. So to get rid of this, the third option is that instead of considering a triode connected load or diode connected load, let us use a current source load. So this is the third option, current source load. Now, in case of triode connected load or diode connected load, the value of RD and the voltage drop across RD, they are strongly coupled. Because if the value of RD is more, obviously for a fixed current, the voltage drop across RT will also be large. So the value of RD and the voltage drop across RT, they were strongly connected. Now we are looking at a current source load, for which, as you know, for an ideal current source, the output impedance, the impedance of a current source, if I consider for an ideal one, it should be very large. It's almost infinity. But however, for a current source load, the value of the output impedance and the drain to source drop is not strongly connected, rather it is weakly connected. So drain to source drop, because obviously we have to replace, so over and above this NMOS transistor, so we should have a PMOS transistor or NMOS transistor, and that will act as a resistance. So the drain to source drop, so obviously the drain and the source terminal should be connected between these two, these two points. For an NMOS device, the drain should be connected to VDD, and for a PMOS device, the source should be connected to the VDD. So we will be looking at the drain to source drop of the device which has been connected on the top of this M1. So if I make any attempt to use a current source load, then the drain to source drop and the value of the output impedance, they are not strongly related, rather they are weakly related, they are weakly coupled. So now let us have a look, how can this problem be arrested using a current source load. So here also, since we are talking about a current source load, so it will provide you a constant current. So automatically we will be using the device in the saturation region so that that can be done. And obviously, since we have already seen that the PMOS transistor can be useful so that the body effect can be avoided. So let me consider that PMOS transistor is connected on the top of this NMOS transistor. So this one is the source terminal, which is connected to VDD. And below this, we have the actual MOS, which will be responsible for amplifying the signal. So input is applied over here, Vin. and this is the output terminal, V out. And obviously, you know, to make it in the saturation region, so some bias potential VB is being provided. So this transistor M1 will act as the amplifying device, and M2 will act as a current source. Now, as M2 is acting as a current source, so if I just take a look at the output impedance of M2, so it will be pretty large. And if I consider the small signal equivalent circuit, then ultimately the gain for this circuit, this entire combination, is given by, so you have the GM1 of the lower transistor or M1, and apart from that, you have the RO1 parallel RO2. So RO1 is the output impedance resulting from the lower transistor, that is M1, and RO2 is the output impedance resulting from the upper transistor, that is M2. So AV is given by GM1 multiplied with RO1 parallel RO2. Now, first of all, we have to take a look at the expression for the drain to source voltage for the upper transistor, because that ultimately limits the corresponding swing of the output voltage. Because as you can see over here, V out can be written like V out is equal to, so you have this VDD minus VDS of M2 mod of VDS of M2. So if VDS by M2, if that value can be kept small, then obviously the corresponding swing at the output terminal could be large. Now, what about the VDS of M2? What about the minimum value of VDS of M2? So VDS, let me write over here only subscript. I think that will be easier to replicate. Yeah, VDS M2. So the fundamental condition that we have to follow here is that this upper transistor M2 must be acting in the saturation region. So the condition in the saturation region is that VDS, for even for NMOS transistor, the value of VDS should be greater than the VGS minus VTH. So if this condition gets satisfied, then we can say that the transistor enters into the saturation region, the MOS enters into the saturation region. So what about the minimum value of VDS? So VDS minimum is given by VGS minus VTH. Now that is true for the NMOS transistor as well as for the PMOS transistor. The only difference is that for a PMOS transistor, I have to find out the corresponding module as well, because VDS for a PMOS transistor will be negative, unlike the NMOS. So VDS M2 mod of this minimum is equal to mod of VGS M2 minus VTH2. So one thing what we have understood is the output voltage swing can be made larger by reducing the value of VDS, but you cannot reduce the value of VDS at per your wish, because there is certain constraint on the value of VDS so as to make or keep the transistor M2 in the saturation, and that value is known as the minimum value of the VDS M2, and that is given by VGS M2 minus VTH2. So to reduce VDS M2, or to reduce this value, what option we have? We can minimize or we can reduce the value of this gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage of this transistor M2. But remember, we are having a constant current flowing through it. So whenever the current is constant, because it is acting in the saturation region, so current is constant, and we are trying to reduce the value of the overdrive voltage, it is also known as overdrive voltage, VGS minus VTH. So under this condition, keeping the current constant or having the current constant, if you make any attempt to reduce the VGS value, so I think it will be better if I just write down the expression for drain current once again. So you have like, so this is true for any device. So let me write for NMOS, half mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So that is the expression in the In fact, you can also have some 1 plus lambda VDS over here. So if the current is constant, that is ID is constant, and if you want to make this VGS minus VTH smaller, VGS minus VTH smaller, so as to have this VDS M2 minimum as small as possible, the only option what you have is to increase the value of W by L. So we would like to minimize or reduce the value of VGS minus VTH to mod of this for M2. We would like to reduce this value for a fixed ID. And that can be done by increasing the W by L ratio. So the option what you have over here is keeping, if I consider that length is constant, so what you can do is you can increase the value of width, but obviously if you make any attempt to increase the value of width, it will be having some adverse effect on the transient response. So that we have already discussed, and it will be elaborately discussed whenever I'll be talking about the frequency response characteristics of the MOS amplifier. So you cannot increase the width of the device at produce choice because it will adversely affect the corresponding frequency response. But if you would like to make the corresponding fluctuation, the voltage swing at the output terminal as high as possible for a fixed current, that is the only option available to you. Moreover, if I look at the value of RO2, that is the output impedance of the second transistor, that is M2. So the another option to increase the value of AV is to increase the value of RO2. RO2. So you can also increase RO2 so as to increase the gain of this overall combination. But how can you increase RO2? As you already we have discussed that RO, the output impedance, is given by 1 by lambda times ID. So for a fixed current, so as long as we are talking about a fixed drain current, that is ID is fixed, so RO can be increased by reducing lambda. For a fixed drain current, the RO can be increased by reducing lambda. Now remember, lambda is having a reciprocal relation with the length of the MOS device, because already we have seen that this delta L by L, as a first order approximation, this delta L by L is given by lambda times VDS. While discussing the channel length modulation, we have already made this particular equation into our consideration, that delta L by L is equal to lambda into VDS. So how to reduce lambda? By increasing L. So if you make any attempt to increase the value of L or length of any device, then it is possible to reduce the value of lambda, and ultimately it will also increase the RO2 or the output impedance of the MOS device. Now let us try to generalize this thing and let us check whether this generalization is correct or not. Now for the lower transistor M1, if we want to increase the gain, so that is true for both M2 and M1, because RO is given by 1 upon lambda ID. This is true for any transistor. Now to increase the gain, your objective will be to increase the output impedance. That means by increasing the value of both RO1 and RO2. And one option to increase RO2 is to increasing the value of the length of the MOS. So now let us separately identify its impact on the lower transistor, that is M1. Now what happens for M1 whenever you would like to increase the value of RO1? So the option that is available to you is that you have to increase the value of L1. Now for this transistor, for the lower transistor, as you can find, the overdrive voltage is inversely proportional to W by L, because for the lower transistor also, as you can see, I think I can take a new slide. So ID is equal to half mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH. whole square. So what we find is that for a constant current, so VGS minus VTH, that value is inversely proportional to 1 upon W by L. For a constant ID, assuming that mu and Cox is constant. So VGS minus VTH is inversely proportional to W by L. So to increase RO1, the option here is to reduce lambda, and that can be done by increasing L. But if you make any attempt to increase the value of L for the lower transistor, then ultimately the corresponding overdrive voltage for a fixed current this overdrive voltage will also increase, and ultimately overdrive voltage will be increasing, and ultimately it will affect the corresponding fluctuation in the output, the voltage swing that we are looking at. Let me clarify this point by drawing the circuit once again. So the option here, so Vin, Vb, this one is Vout. This is grounded. And this one is VDD. So to increase RO1, you have to reduce the value of lambda, and that can be done by using a higher value of L. So if you make any attempt to increase the value of L by some factor, say alpha, then what happens? You have to increase the value of the W as well, width of the transistor as well, because if you do not increase the value of W, but if you increase the value of L only for the lower transistor M1, then what happens? The corresponding overdrive voltage, which is inversely proportional to W by L, will also increase with increasing L. If the overdrive voltage increases, you understand that VDS, that is given by over here for the lower transistor VDS of M1, which is nothing but simple Vout. Now, if the overdrive voltage increases, that is, if VGS minus VTH increases, it will ultimately restrict the corresponding fluctuation of the output voltage. So this is not a good option available to us. So if you want to make a higher value of L, so accordingly, you have to increase a higher value of W. So if I want to write down the final expression for the gain, so that is nothing but GM times RO1 parallel RO2. And in fact, we can select RO2 to be large with respect to RO1. So that can be approximated to GM times RO1 only, assuming RO2 is large. And that is our objective. By increasing the value of the output impedance by utilizing it as a current source. So GM times RO1. What is that expression? GM1 rather. And that expression is given by root over of twice mu n Cox W by L of the lower transistor, that is M1, into ID. That is the expression for GM1, and R1 can be written like lambda times ID. So here, as you can find, as L increases, this expression will be small. Expression inside the square root will be small as L increases. But remember, as L increases, the corresponding value of 1 upon lambda will also increase. Now we have two different dependents. Here, the corresponding variation is under the square root. So here it will vary with respect to 1 upon root L, and here it will vary with respect to root L only. So this entire thing, it varies with 1 upon root L, and this one varies with L, because 1 by lambda can be written like, say, L by delta L also. So lambda is inversely proportional to L, so 1 upon lambda is directly proportional to L. So since these two are multiplied, so ultimately the overall expression for gain will depend upon L, and the dependence is given by root L. So if I increase the value of L, if L is increased, then the expression for gain mod AV will also increase. And another thing what we can observe from here is that the corresponding dependence on ID, so here it will depend, I mean the corresponding variation is with respect to root ID, and here the corresponding variation is with respect to 1 upon ID. So if I take these two different components into account, then we can find that ultimately it will be proportional to, I mean the expression for gain is proportional to 1 upon root ID. So AV, what you can see, in one word, mod AV is proportional to root L, and mod AV is also proportional to root ID. So increasing L will obviously increase the expression for the gain, and reducing the bias current also, this drain current that is flowing, you can also increase the expression for the gain. And moreover, you cannot increase the value of L only, because if you increase the value of L only, then what happens? The W by L ratio will be small. For the lower transistor, if you increase the value of L only, keeping W constant, suppose this is constant, and if you make any attempt to increase the value of L, then overall this W by L ratio will drop down. And remember, if W by L ratio drops down, this will adversely affect the value of GM, that is the mutual conductance of the first transistor, and ultimately the gain will also drop. So the option that is available to us is that for the lower transistor, it will be wise to increase both the value of W and L. Because just by increasing L, in one sense, you can see that the mod of AV is increasing, that is fine. Keeping W constant, if you increase the value of L, then ultimately it will reduce the value of W by L ratio. And this W by L ratio is proportional to GM. I mean, GM is proportional to root over of W by L. And as a matter of fact, if you reduce the value of W by L, it will adversely impact the expression for GM. And ultimately, the expression for gain will also be reduced. But however, if I just use this current source load, then obviously that dependence between the value of the output impedance and the corresponding drain to source fluctuation is, since it is weakly coupled, it's not heavily coupled, since it is weakly coupled. So the previous limitations that we have encountered so far using the diode connected load or triode connected load or simple resistance RT like this, so that limitations were So I think, yeah, I mean, I can go to that slide. Yeah, for diode connected load like this, so we have a resistance, basically we have a resistance connected between this drain and the source terminal. And if you make any attempt to increase the value of RD, then automatically the corresponding fluctuation at the source terminal over here for this transistor, for this upper transistor, is reduced, and as a matter of fact, the corresponding voltage swing is limited. So to get rid of this difficulty, this current source load has been introduced, in which case we are using a PMOS transistor on the top of an NMOS transistor, and this PMOS transistor is operated in the saturation region, and ultimately the value of this VGS minus VTH, I mean the mod value of VGS minus VTH, can be reduced, and that can be done by simply increasing the value of this W by L ratio for the upper transistor or M2. But even for this kind of combination, if you make any attempt to proportionally increasing the value of W by L ratio, then ultimately it will affect the transient analysis of the amplifier. But so far we have not considered the transient analysis. Rather, so far we have considered these different attributes. So I think it will be better if I write down the attributes. So far we are looking at, first one is the gain, second one is the linearity, how far the gain is linear, and obviously the voltage swing. In fact, there are other parameters as well, voltage swing at output node. In fact, there are other parameters like the power consumption, we do have the input impedance, output impedance, and that issues will be taken up together. And we do have the corresponding transient analysis, the bandwidth, the time constant. So there are different attributes, but so far we have made a comparative analysis between these different common source amplifier with respect to these different parameters, with respect to gain, with respect to linearity, and with respect to the voltage swing and output node. And we can understand what are the corresponding advantages and what are the corresponding limitations for each of these different combinations. In fact, we do have another combination left, that is the common source state with the source degeneration, but that part I think we don't have enough time today. So hopefully that part might be discussed in the next class. Now with this, with these three different architectures of common source amplifier, I would like to conclude this class.